واحد المنعام والصلاة والسلام على محمد سيد الأنام وعلى آله الكرام وصحبه العظام وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى ومن يتق الله يجعل له مخرجا وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في رمضان ينادي مناد يا باغي الخير أقبل ويا باغي الشر أقصر أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters and youngsters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator and sustainer, and we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. We continue to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he shower his mercy and his bounties upon us during this blessed season, in particular the final 10 days of the blessed month of Ramadan. May Allah give us the itqum minan nar. May Allah give us the emancipation from the hellfire. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. Ramadan is generally a time when we reflect and we reform ourselves. We bring transformation into ourselves. We bring a positive change into ourselves. And Ramadan is an opportunity to reinforce this positive change so that it lasts even after the month of Ramadan. And there are very clear examples that I'm sure we all experience. Many of us, outside Ramadan, we say things like, I need my coffee in the morning. If I don't have my coffee or my tea, I am disturbed, I have headaches. But we've been doing it for the last 19, 20 days. So this is an example, and this is a reality, a practical example and a reality that the impossible can become possible. In Ramadan, we've proven it. When we look at the human being generally has four types of greeds, four types of shahwa. The ulama say the first is shahwatul batn, the desire, the greed for food to fill our bellies, to fill our stomachs. So there's a constant desire and we want the food to get better and better. And then the next is shahwatul farj. We have the greed to satisfy our sexual passions, our sexual appetite, and it increases. And the ulama continue, they say, shahwatul mal. Another one is that we have this greed for wealth. We have this greed for material to acquire more and more of this world. And finally, the ulama say, shahwatul jah, the desire for position, for authority, for name and fame, for glamour. So the ulama give a very beautiful example. We are like a barren piece of land. We are like, every human being, every one of us, we are like a barren piece of land, an empty piece of land. If we leave that land in its position the way it is, it's gonna start growing weeds, useless plantation, valueless vegetation. And that continues to grow. And the longer it stays on that land, the more difficult it will be to remove that useless herb or the weeds and the grass that is on that land. So our example is that, like that land, we need to cultivate that land. We need to constantly bring in positive habits into our lives. We need to constantly make efforts to do good so that that land remains of value. That land remains of status and it becomes of benefit. It becomes fruitful. Things that we can use, plantations and vegetation, fruits that we can use. This is the example of the believer. So the month of Ramadan is an opportunity to reinforce ourselves in these good habits and to remove from ourselves the habits that are inappropriate, that will be considered negative. And this is why in Surah Al-Ibrahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a very profound example of a believer and how firm and strong a believer is. Not only in the month of Ramadan, but in general. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that, do you not see the parable? أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. Allah gives you a beautiful parable. كَنِمَةً طَيِّبَةً. It's the example, it's the parable of a strong, good statement. And what is it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the parable, gives the example. كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. The example is like a tree. It's deeply rooted. أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ. Its roots are strongly embedded into the earth. And as it grows, its branches reach the sky. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلِكَ يَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالِ. Allah gives you this profound example of the firmness of a believer. So a believer is firmly rooted in good habits, in good works, in things that are positive and pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the reverse, in the very same verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the example of an individual who's weak, an individual who can be blown away with the wind. When a person is in the wrong environment, they're doing the wrong. When a person is triggered to do evil and sin, this person cannot discipline, this person cannot control, this person is easily trapped into that sin and that evil. So Allah gives the example. The example is like كَشَجَرَةٍ خَبِيثَ. It's like a weak tree. It's like a weak اُجْتُثَّتْ مِنْ فَوْقِ الْأَرْضِ. It's uprooted from the surface of the earth. So you have a tree, but the roots are not embedded into the earth. So it's weak, it's unstable. مَا لَهَا مِنْ قَرَارٍ. There's no stability for that tree. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the example of a person who's weak, a person who's sinful, a person who's not firm and embedded in the good values. So Ramadan is the opportunity for you and I to embed ourselves, to strengthen our roots, to inculcate good habits, to reinforce them, and then continue on throughout the rest of the year. And this is why we need to make a concentrated effort on looking at our habits. You know, like the ulama, they say that we should analyze ourselves before Ramadan, and we should analyze ourselves after the completion of Ramadan. If we see even one habit that we have changed positively, then we can say, Alhamdulillah, our Ramadan was a success. Even one habit that was wrong, we've abandoned, we've left it, we've forsaked it, we've asked Allah for forgiveness, and we never continue on that path. Even one habit, then our Ramadan most certainly will be fruitful. So, we need to look at our habits. We need to look at our daily activities. As the saying goes, that we form our habits, but then our habits form us. We form our habits, we choose our habits, but then after some time, those habits actually control us. They move us. So we need to be very careful in our daily activities. That are my habits, are my daily activities positive, pleasing to the Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or are they negative? So if we want to remove ourselves from bad habits, because as human beings we all have bad habits, there's no one that's perfect. But as I said, Ramadan is an opportunity to look at these habits and reform ourselves for the better. So the first step is we need to recognize and admit our bad habits. So we have certain things that we do, we know it's wrong, but we continue doing it. We know it's a sin, but we continue to engage in it. So we need to admit that this is a sin and I need to abandon it. This is something that is wrong, it's inappropriate, I have to leave it. We have to acknowledge and admit this is the beginning of any problem, any solution that we want to acquire. We have to admit that there's a problem. We study the life of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Whenever the Prophet ﷺ supplicated, he said things like, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. O Allah, there's none worthy of worship except you. Subhanak, you are free from defects. O Allah, if there's someone that has defects, it's me. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. O Allah, I am the one that's on the wrong. Inni ashku ilayka bathi. The Prophet ﷺ on the night of Badr. Badr took place in the month of Ramadan, the 17th of Ramadan. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he pray for? He prayed that truth prevails. He prayed that falsehood is removed from the earth. He prayed that sin be wiped out of the earth and humanity hastens towards good. So what did he start off with? He said, Ashku bathi. Oh Allah, I express, acknowledge and admit my weakness before you. So this is the first step, that we need to acknowledge our weakness. We need to acknowledge our sin. If we want to inculcate good habits and leave the bad habits, we need to first acknowledge that this is a sin and I need to leave it. I need to abandon it. And Ramadan is a time where we can easily do it because there is spiritual strength from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is spiritual power that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the one who is conscious, meaning the one who knows, the one who is conscious about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah will make a path for them. Allah will make an exit for them to come out of what they are doing that is inappropriate. So we have to acknowledge. Number two is that we need to remove all the triggers. We need to remove anything that triggers a sin. So an example, if I am a person who constantly wastes time online, then I need to mentally prepare myself that I will only use the computer at these certain times of the day for these specific activities. And if it's after that or before that, it's a zone that I cannot enter. Because it's gonna trigger me. If I'm gonna sit there, I have nothing to do, and I'm gonna sit in front of the computer, I'm gonna go on this site and that site, and next thing I know, 2 hours are wasted. 3 hours are gone. So we have to remove the triggers. A person has bad company. And they know that when they get a call from this so-called buddy, let's go, it's Friday night, it's Saturday night, let's go out. We know that as soon as I go into that company, I'm gonna waste time, I'm gonna get myself into no good, I'm gonna do things that are inappropriate, and then when it's all done, I'm gonna remorse, I'm gonna regret, I'm gonna be guilty. So I need to remove the trigger. I have to say, I can't be in that company. I have to make a choice. I have to make a choice. I have to remove the trigger. Some of us cannot control our eating habits. So the fridge should be a zone where we don't go near except if it's breakfast, lunch or dinner. If it's after or before that, it's a zone that we're not supposed to be near. So that we can start inculcating our habits. Eating habits, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he was very cautious about the way he ate and what he ate. And in terms of his health, the Prophet ﷺ's stomach and his chest was in line, in a narration of Tirmidhi. The Prophet ﷺ's stomach and his chest was in line. He wasn't obese. He wasn't a person who ate things when it was not necessary to eat. So this is a time, Ramadan is a time to be careful about these habits and then continue on these good habits so that we change our lives for the better. So we need to remove the triggers. Number one is that we have to acknowledge that we have wrong habits. We have inappropriate habits. Number two is we need to remove those things that would trigger us. And, you know, it's very sad what happened in the United States in terms of the Sikh temple shooting. And also the mosque that was burnt down, the masjid that was burnt down. And there's all this discussion on the news. People analyzing the situation. But, you know, one perspective we need to all ask ourselves is this one, that there are so many triggers of violence. People are asking the question, how can an individual come to a peaceful place of worship and just shoot people that are innocent, that have no crime whatsoever? This is a question that everyone's asking. How can a madman just burned down a masjid, a place of worship, in a small town where there's about 50 Muslims and that masjid is the central focus of that Muslim community. And now they don't have a mosque, they don't have a masjid. So what can trigger this? So one perspective is, we claim to say we are peaceful nations. We claim to say we are peaceful people. But then we'll line up at a movie theater will pay $20-$30 to watch violence. We'll purchase video games for our children. And those video games have nothing to do with peace. It's all about shooting the enemy. It's all about shooting this one and that one. And we have all these gadgets. We have billions of dollars. Look at the movie industry. Millions of dollars. It's just released, and within a day or two, you have millions of dollars. And we're paying to watch this. And then we're saying we're a peaceful nation. We're saying we're going into these countries to spread peace. So there's all these triggers that are creating this type of hate. It's creating this type of violence. It's creating this type of instability within our communities. Islam teaches us, get rid of those habits. Get rid of those triggers. The Prophet, peace, imagine, the Prophet ﷺ is ma'soom. He's innocent. He cannot commit sin. It's our aqeedah, it's our belief. But yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to him, don't go near those things that would trigger sin. What does Allah say in the Quran? وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاةِ وَالْعَشِيِّ. O Messenger of Allah, stay firm in the company of those people who constantly remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Referring to the companions, referring to the Sahaba. The Prophet ﷺ doesn't need this advice, but Allah is commanding him. Meaning, stay away from anything that triggers negative, that triggers sin, that triggers instability. And in reality, it's a message for you and I. So if we're going to be surrounded by things that trigger sin and evil, we won't be able to get rid of our habits. We need to identify our sin, we need to acknowledge our evil and our wrong habits, and we need to also remove those things that trigger those sins and those evil habits. Number three is we need to replace our bad habits with habits that are good. So if I have, taking the same example, if I have a habit of wasting time online, on the internet, now I have this extra time, so I need to replace it. Do a workout, you know, play a game of sport, get healthy, you know, go for a walk, go visit your mom or dad, go visit a friend that will bring positive contribution to your life. Do something that is productive. Come volunteer at the masjid. Go volunteer at Cancer Society, whatever it may be. So do something that is good. Replace the bad. If we're not going to replace the bad with good, we're going to continue on the bad. And we see this in the life of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Umar radiallahu anhu, we know his nature, his temperament. He was very bold. He was very abrupt. He was aggressive. Umar radiallahu anhu would always become angry. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, told him after he accepted Islam, I may not be able to change your temperament, but I am appealing to you to now channel your boldness for the right cause. You were using your boldness and your anger and your temperament for the inappropriate causes. I'm appealing to you, use your anger and your boldness for things that are appropriate. Where there's supposed to be anger, I want to see anger. Where there's supposed to be passion and boldness, I want to see that passion and boldness there. So what is the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, teaching Umar radiallahu anhu? Replace the bad with good. So we have a whole lot of bad habits, but if we don't replace with good habits, then we're going to continue on. It's like, a person gave an example. You have a container, and there's filthy water in it. It's black, it's brown. Now, one way to get rid of it is to open and to pour it. But getting rid of our habits is not that easy. We don't just pour ourselves out of our bad habits. What we need to do is another way. If I ask you, what's a way to get rid of this filthy water from the container without pouring it? Is we're going to add clean water to it. Continue to add clean water. Keep on adding clean water. And automatically, the filthy water will be removed. And that's why there's a fiqh principle in Tahara, that if you have a large quantity of water, and you put in filthy water in that large quantity, then it remains pure. So, we need to inculcate good habits. And those good habits will eliminate the bad habits. We need to replace our bad habits with good habits. And finally, we need that spiritual strength. And that spiritual strength comes from dua, from supplication, from prayer, from connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from making sujood and prostration before the Creator. And what better time is there than the month of Ramadan to habituate ourselves with this type of connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I started off with a narration where the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is speaking about the month of Ramadan. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us that every single night in Ramadan, there is a caller, there is an announcer. And what does this announcer, possibly an angel, what does this angel say? Ya baghi al khayri aqbil. Oh, the one that is doing good, continue doing good. Don't stop. Wa ya baghi al shar. And oh, the one that is doing evil and sin, aqsir. Reduce your evil. Stop your evil. Pause. And then continue on this path of goodness and refraining from evil. So every single night, the announcer, the angel is announcing, as mentioned by the Prophet ﷺ. Now it's up to you and I to take that seriously. I was just speaking to a brother who was telling me about his family talking to a revert. And this revert, before he accepted Islam, he was interested in Islam. And he was studying the Quran, he was asking questions. But whenever they asked him, whenever this family asked him, so why don't you say the Shahada? Why don't you accept Islam? He said, I have all these bad habits. I drink wine. I party and I do, you know, I have illegitimate relations. And if I accept Islam, I have to leave all this. So the family convinced the brother that, you know, the first step is that you accept. If you recognize that Allah is the Creator and the Quran is the truth, Islam is the truth, then even if you have your bad habits, slowly they will come away. So he was convinced. He accepted Islam. And then, this brother was telling me that the first Ramadan for him was the last Ramadan. And that Ramadan was the turning point for this person. This person realized that in Ramadan, I'm able to stay away from food for so many hours, for 17 hours. If I can stay away from food, I can stay away from speaking vulgar language. I can stay away from cheating and lying. I can stay away from the wine, alcohol, from things that are evil and sinful. So people are changing their lives. They're transforming through the month of Ramadan. We have to ask ourselves, Ramadan's come and go. How am I transforming? How am I leaving my bad habits and bringing in and inculcating good habits in my life? It'll happen when we take it seriously by acknowledging our wrong habits, by removing all the triggers, by replacing the bad with good, and by constantly gaining spiritual strength through connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this Ramadan for us a transformation for each and every one of us. May Allah allow us to abandon all our bad habits. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to replace them with good. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our qiyam, our fasting, our prayers in this blessed month. And may Allah grant us all the success of this world and the everlasting life of the year after. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب